Tomorrow is Earth Day, and I will focus today on the Earth and our interconnected relationship with the Earth, but first I must acknowledge the twist in my title. The real pro-life, I say, is pro-Earth. Of course, pro-life means something else to most people. Pro-life is a slogan, a stance, that specifically refers to the anti-abortion stance in the reproductive rights debate happening in our country. Pro-life is one side of the debate between these two sides. My convictions land me on the pro-choice side when we are limited to picking sides in the debate. I remember years back reading an argument that in terms of slogans, not the actual position, just the slogan, pro-life was a clear winner. Who doesn't support life? It's similar to the argument that the name universalism is a winner. You mean everything? How can you argue against everything? Just in terms of the name, the slogan, pro-life, it's a great idea to get behind. Yes, I am in favor of life. And I am far from the first to suggest that in truth, the pro-life crowd is not really pro-life. They are pro-birth. That stance, known as pro-life, is really a small, narrow focus to promote birth. And when I allow my more suspicious side to speak, I would say it is a contrived power play to control women more than anything else. And this idea that life begins at conception is a very Western Christian philosophy. Other religious traditions have different answers. Judaism, for example, claims that life begins with the first breath. And science seeks a definition between conception and birth when scientists speak in terms of viability outside the uterus. It really is just Christians who argue that life begins, that ensoulment occurs at conception. There is not a universal agreement about the point at which life begins, especially as it pertains to the termination of a pregnancy. But I'm not all that interested in that part of the debate, if I'm honest. When we can step back from slogans and debates about when life begins, when we really allow an honoring of life to lead us, then I can joyfully claim a pro-life stance. I can see a person's choice to terminate a pregnancy as a choice made within an authentic honoring of life. I can do this because I see life and death intertwined, because I have a larger understanding of life beyond mere birth, because the real pro-life stance expands far beyond a debate about reproductive rights and abortions. A real pro-life stance cares for people every day after birth as well. A real pro-life stance also promotes universal health care and fair housing. A real pro-life stance works to build systems of support for children and families and communities. A real pro-life stance fights against poverty and racism. Stance against hunger and the spread of disease. A real pro-life stance protects our earth, our water, from poisons and oil spills and the ravages of capitalist greed. A real pro-life stance is also pro-earth, not merely pro-birth. And the earth is brimming with examples of the interplay of life and death, the ebb and flow of the tides, the turning of the seasons each year, the life cycle of dragonflies. The natural world shows us the way of life, the way filled with beginnings and endings and returnings, cycles of growth and decay and new life. In this perspective, the termination of a pregnancy is held within the ongoing give and take of life. It is, in this perspective, the urgency of denying death, of refusing endings, is eased by the context of cycles and circles and life ever returning. Is this an Earth Day sermon? Yes. Is this a pro-choice sermon? Yes. Really? Both? Yes. Because it's about the intersectionality and the interdependence. I want to not compartmentalize the conversations into little boxes as if they don't overlap. Because what we know of the earth can help us to understand the complexity of a situation involving abortion. Why, for example, do we argue between the life of the fetus and the life of the mother as if the two are not deeply intertwined? It is such an individualistic perspective to assume that the best way to decide is to pick one over the other. When we turn people into the other, we build distance and disconnection. That is where hatred and oppression can thrive. But a person working through the choice to terminate a pregnancy is perhaps the most elegant example of interdependence. There are layers of impact and import in those scenarios. Why would we isolate people in situations like this, demand they value only one thing, this life or that life, when all life is interconnected? Philosopher Charles Taylor talks about the balance of positive and negative aspects of individualism. He writes, "We live in a world where people have a right to choose for themselves their own pattern of life, to decide in conscience what convictions to espouse. The dark side of individualism is a centering on the self, which both flattens and narrows our lives, makes them poorer in meaning, and less concerned with others or society. Too often, we push ourselves and we push others into this flattened and narrowed place of isolation. What can real support look like for someone facing this decision? Every choice is a story. Here's what I do not know. I have never been and never will be pregnant. I will never experience new life growing within me like that. I will never face the choice to terminate that pregnancy or to not. What I do know is that every choice is a story. What I do know is that whichever way such a decision goes, none of us are truly alone. We may be isolated, but we are not alone. When we are feeling stuck or isolated or pressured by society, it can be of great help to reconnect with nature. I know that can sound like a bit of a non sequitur to suggest. I'm struggling with a decision. Have you checked in with the rushing river and the ants? Have you taken your troubles to the maple trees and the dandelions? I know how that might sound, but we can reframe that and ask the same question with just different words. We can ask, when is your next appointment with your therapist? Or have you prayed with God about this? Or have you made art or done journaling or checked in with your mother or your best friend about it? Really, the question is this. When you are struggling with a decision, have you connected? For me, the earth is a connection to life. For you, it may be different, and you may find your connections in other ways. But I will still smile and say, we can all grow in our connection with the earth. Buddhist monk Thich Nhat Hanh has written, when we suffer, the earth embraces us, accepts us, restores our energy, making us strong and stable again. The relief that we seek is right under our feet and all around us. Much of our suffering can be healed if we realize this, if we understand our deep connection and relationship with the earth. We have enough love, strength, and awakening to look after ourselves and the earth so that both can thrive. The suffering is about not being connected. When I can slow myself enough to remember my deep connection and relationship with the earth, I find the resources and the reasons for all of my efforts to build a better world, a more connected world. When I can sit among the tall trees and the undergrowth, breathe in the breeze and the beauty, these things become part of me and keep me grounded. My small, isolated self expands, and I become part of the intricate and connected pattern of this life. Experiencing life this way is why I care about the environment and about reproductive rights and about racism and peace and clean water. When I see myself as part of the pattern, as part of life with a capital L, as part of God, if you will, I become a partner with all that is, the beauty and the pain, the ebb and the flow, the war and oppression, and the gentle breeze and the songs of birds. This is why I care, because I feel the connections. When things are tight, when there is pressure to be isolated, reach out and get connected. When I can slow myself down enough to really experience life, then I find myself in the pattern of things. And every isolated, lonely act becomes reframed and held in the grace of connection. And together we thrive, even through the heartbreak and hard decisions. We thrive. May we lean in to our connections. May we walk closer to what looks like trouble. And may we thrive. In a world without end, may it be so. Let us join together in singing our closing hymn. It is 301 in our hymnals.